Hi, my name's John Downs, and welcome to the February 2009 edition of On the Track. Strange year indeed. The year was only a week old when the strangeness started. I received an email. What are you going to be doing about the Beast of the Bay? The email read. I had no idea. I asked off.
What's the Beast of the Bay?
He said. I don't know, I said.
What are we going to do about it?
He said. I don't know, I said.
Why don't you email the person who told you about the Beast of the Bay and ask what it is?
He said. What a jolly good idea, I said. So I emailed them back, and I received this picture.
It's a dead seal,
said I.
It's a bold policeman,
said Ross.
It's a bloody waste of time,
said Graham. He was right in one way, because we'd originally been told that this was the body of the Beast of Exmoor.
It's a boring afternoon,
said I.
Can we go and get it? It would be quite cool to have a seal skull in our museum.
Why not, said I.
I am not having a putrid dead seal in my kitchen,
said my darling wife Karina.
It's nothing to do with me,
said my darling stepdaughter Shoshana, who wasn't even here at the time. So the game was afoot. Holy smoke, land sakes alive, I never thought this could happen
to me. Say what you like about the CFZ, but when we get the bit between our teeth, we're an unstoppable crypto machine. First stop was Torridge Training in Biddeford's Easter Water, where CFZ operative Matt Osborne works.
Hello.
Hello. Ready to feast, Hansen?
Yep. We didn't have a hatchet, but I got a drill saw that will go through bay.
I think in the first week in January, he was quite pleased to have an excuse to bunk off work for the afternoon as well. I guess I'd better give you the backstory. Basically, what had happened was, the night before, two policemen from Braunton Police Station in North Devon had been called to Croyd Beach by a member of the public claiming that they had found a mysterious corpse. Well, of course, they went rushing out. Mysterious corpse sounded like it could be anything from an axe murder downwards. Actually, it was the suffering seal skeleton. We wanted the body for our museum purely so that we could put one small cryptozoological mystery to bed once and for all. However, as the boys were speeding their way towards Croyd Beach, I had a telephone call.
Yeah, I have seen the picture. Yeah, it's quite interesting, but I think it's a seal. What? You must be kidding. Who says that it's not a seal? If it's not a seal, what is it then? A sea lion? Well, if it's a sea lion, it could be something really interesting. I better get back to you on this.
The thing is, there are no sea lions in British waters. There are seals, but sea lions aren't found any closer than colonies on the Atlantic coast of Argentina, many, many thousands of miles away. However, back in the 1980s, a sea lion did turn up in British waters. A solitary sea lion lived for some years on some rocks called the Brysons, off the coast of southern Cornwall. So, if it had happened once, could it have happened again? Suddenly, Olin Graham's excursion to while away a boring afternoon had taken on considerable more importance. Then I received another telephone call.
Yeah, so the beach is private property. And you're going to make sure that we're arrested. You're going to make sure that if we take away the rotting skull of a seal, we're going to get arrested. Oh, for heaven's sake.
Well, this was going to be good for my anarchist credibility, if nothing else. But it had been 20 years or so since I'd been last involved in any serious civil disobedience, and I'm now nearly 50 years old. If it was just going to be all about the head of the seal, we'd have given up and I'd have aborted the mission. But there was still the possibility that this might be a scientific specimen almost second to none. Only the second sea lion ever to turn up in British waters. And was I going to let that slip through my fingers just because of a few laws about aggravated trespass? Was I heck? So I warned Karina that she'd probably have to end up making some banners saying free the CFZ4, and that she'd have to contact my two stepdaughters and various other CFZ worthies to mount a protest march outside the police station, where we would certainly be being held in durance vile. But on a more serious note, I made another telephone call, this time to Matty Osborne.
Okay guys, I think we might have a problem. We've been told that we are in imminent danger of being arrested. Yeah, arrested if we take it away, but we've got to take it away. I'm going to phone the landlords if I possibly can, and I'm going to phone the police. Just be careful.
Have they heard about it in the shop at all?
No, they haven't. They've heard nothing. But they say that Croyde Bay is quite small compared to the other beaches around here, so it shouldn't be difficult to find.
That's good news.
So as the intrepid team approached Croyde Bay, I desperately first tried to phone the police, and then tried to phone the holiday company who owned the beach. Braunton is a small town, and the police station isn't manned 24/7. I left a message on the answer phone and hoped for best. I had slightly more luck with the holiday company, because although I couldn't find anybody at the holiday camp in Braunton themselves, I did manage to speak to a nice girl called Kim. She was part of the telephone sales team, and I asked her very nicely if she would make a completely accurate note of what I was about to say. I told her that we were in no means intending to permanently deprive her employers, the owners, of the mysterious carcass of any part of the body, but because we believed that it could possibly be of serious scientific interest and that we wanted to save it for posterity and for imminent scientific analysis, we were intending to take it away. This was obviously the most fun Kim had had for weeks, and she was wildly excited about the whole affair. "Don't worry, pet," she said. "I'm sure you're not going to get arrested for it. After all, what would a holiday camp want with the rotting head of a seal?" We both laughed. She wished me good luck and put the phone down. I then phoned Matthew again.
"Make sure that nobody sees you do it. And guys, for heaven's sake, don't do any damage to the body. That's the most important thing. If we do any damage to the body, we can get done for criminal damage. So make sure if we do take the skull, we take away the skull because it has fallen off naturally. That's important."
I think that for most people, the idea of wandering around on a beach in the middle of winter when the beach is covered in ice, dusk is coming in, and you don't really know where you're going, but all you do know is that you're on the search for an animal that might be 5 foot long and is going to stink to high heaven, would not really be your idea of fun. However, if you think that, you're not part of the CFZ. They clambered across the icy rocks, walked from one end of the beach to the other along the tide line, and were just about to give up hope when I telephoned with some more information that I had got from one of my contacts.
"Get back on the beach to search for it. Above the tide line, at down end. When we find it, we'll call it back."
And then they found it. It was undoubtedly a pinniped, and it was undoubtedly what my late mother would have called very dead indeed. It was far too large to be able to manhandle back to the car, and even if they had, what on earth would we have done with it? We simply did not have the resources to store 5 or 6 foot long cadavers sinking to high heaven. I'm very proud of the team, though, that they were so mindful of what I had told them earlier.
"And guys, for heaven's sake, don't do any damage to the body. That's the most important thing. If we do any damage to the body, we can get done for criminal damage. So make sure if we do take the skull, we take away the skull because it has fallen off naturally."
Here I'd like to stress that the people who had warned us that we were going to get arrested, and indeed the people who I believe were the ones who'd actually dobbed us into the Sun newspaper a couple of days later, were actually a rival photo agency who didn't want to photographers to pinch the skull because they were hoping to be able to send more and more photographers to be able to make money out of the demise of this poor unfortunate pinhead. When we finally did get to speak to the police, after having been accused of theft in the Sun, they couldn't have been nicer. They were charming, supportive and helpful, and genuinely interested in what we had found. But what was it that we had found? We filmed and photographed every stage of the recovery operation, from wrapping it in a CFZ tarpaulin, to taking it home and photographing it again, to the moment when Richard finally plonked it into a bucket of formaldehyde and left it in the CFZ Museum. But was it a sea lion, I hear you asking? Well, no, of course it was. It was what we had thought from the beginning, a grey seal. But that's almost not the point. The fact is that right at the start, several newspapers had identified it as being the mysterious carcass of a beast of Exmoor. Now, as you all know, the Beast of Exmoor is a large cat-like creature which has been reported for the last 30-odd years across the southwest. It is certainly not a seal. The Beast of Exmoor has never reputedly had flippers. But if we hadn't done what we had done, the story would have remained around for decades. If we hadn't gone out and investigated the body, then the conspiracy theorists would have run riot, and within a few months, there would have been a large urban legend right across the internet that once again the body of the mysterious Beast of Exmoor had been spirited away by the authorities. This opens up several cans of worms. Firstly, why is it that people are so paranoid about the authorities? As regular viewers will know, I'm not a great fan of the government. Indeed, I'm not a great fan of governments in general. But I draw the line at assuming that everything strange that happens in society is down to the Machiavellian machinations of secret government departments. Sometimes, as in the case of the Dead Seal, stuff just happens. The second, and in many ways the most important can of worms that the whole affair has opened, is how can people be so ignorant about our native wildlife? A cursory look at the first photograph told us that what we were dealing with was a seal, or certainly a pinniped of some sort. But over the next few days, at least three university-educated pundits, journalists, and to his shame, a spokesman for a well-known conservation organisation, identified the skull as being that of the Beast of Exmoor. Something seriously is wrong when such well-educated people can be so appallingly ignorant of some of the basic facts about the natural world. But it's time to get off my soapbox, because it's time for a competition. In last month's episode, I played this music over a piece about the possible survival of the Javan tiger. And I asked, why was I playing it? Who was it by, and what was the name of the song? Well, the answer was, of course, Marianne Faithfull's rendition of Kurt Vile's song Surabaya Johnny. I played it due to the references to tiger hunting in Burma, and mostly because Surabaya is a place in Java. I was very gratified that so many of you got the answer right, but the prize goes to Colin Higgins from Holmfirth in Yorkshire. He came up with it first, and he also read something which I found rather gratifying. Now, to be quite honest, I find it really touching. Apparently, as soon as On the Track comes out, the whole family sit down to watch it together. And so I just want to say hi to Tom, age 2, and Alfie, age 11, who are apparently fans of my stupid ramblings. Thank you, my dears. You've made an aging cryptozoologist very happy and ever so slightly emotional. Now, on to this month's competition. And yes, the Higgins family are still welcome to try it again. What was the music I was playing over much of this story about the skull of the seal on Croyd Beach? I'm not going to ask you why I was playing it. I was playing it because it fitted and I'm rather fond of it. But what's the name of the song? Who wrote it? And what is the link between the people who wrote the song and a lesser-known cryptid known as the Ethiopian devil bird? Once again, the first person who emails me with the answer will have a book of their choice from the CFZ catalogue. Good luck, guys. You didn't want love, Johnny. Well, what else has been happening in the wonderful world of the CFZ? Well, as I told you last month, we have got a new website. It took me 5 or 6 weeks to code, but in the second week of January we finally went live with it. However, being a glutton for punishment, I decided that we would update the news pages every day. Then the news pages expanded, and it turned into a funny sort of bloggo. Yes, the word is bloggo, a word I made up myself, because I refuse to call it an automatic news aggregator, and I refuse to call it an international community blog, and I've been talked into calling it Cryptozoology Online. And it's rapidly becoming one of the world's premier cryptozoological resources, because, without really meaning to, I seem to have started a daily cryptozoological magazine. Twice a day I post 3 or 4 articles ranging in length from 200 words to 2,500 words. Some of them are written just by ordinary people in the rank and file of the cryptozoological community, whereas others are written by such respected researchers as Dr. Karl Schuker and the Czech explorer Ivan Makeli. All the familiar faces of the world of the CFZ are here. Tim, Fleur, Karina, me, Richard, Max, Matty and all. And we even coax Graham out of his solitary splendour on occasions to comment on something exciting that's just happened in the world of cryptozoology. So if you don't already do so, why not come and take a look? I'm sure you won't regret it. Regular CFZ watchers will remember that nearly 5 years ago, I spent 3 and a bit weeks in Illinois, in the heartland of the American Midwest. I fell in love with the place and with the people. And almost as an afterthought, I found that there were a whole string of Fortean mysteries there needing to be solved. I have been meaning to go back and work on the cryptozoology of Illinois ever since. But just after Christmas, I got an email from a young man who offered to help. His name is Derek Grebner, and he's a fine young man and a bloody excellent woodsman. Furthermore, I told him in a Facebook chat only a few weeks ago about the results of my research into the idea that there were actually melanistic mountain lions or pumas in the Shawnee National Forest in the southern parts of the state, and within days he'd got a lot of new information for me. He now has one of the most popular blogs on the CFZ blog network, or should I say a bloggo network, and it is chock full of information that I had never heard before about surviving populations of pumas, bobcats, aberrant wolves, and even a bear. But that's another story and you're going to have to wait for that one. In a few short weeks, Derek has become a very important part of the CFZ New World operation. And my long postponed idea of an expedition to Illinois to try and solve some of these mysteries once and for all has been taken off the back burner and is now looking like it's going to be a definite reality.
I've decided to work with the CFZ, which is Center for Fortean Zoology. They're based out of Britain. And as I am based here in Illinois and an avid outdoorsman, one of the things that I can critique certain cryptozoology or monster hunting shows on is their lack of field experience. They go out, they look for, say, Bigfoot, the Yeti, mystery animals, and they don't do it in the way that a hunter would. They don't worry about scent control. They don't worry about the amount of people they've got in the area. So, as a woodsman and a conservationist, I have decided to work with the Center for Fortean Zoology. My friend John Downs does a show called On the Track on YouTube. I will post a link to the CFZ website. So, they have asked me to collect reports, credible reports of mountain lions in Illinois, where I am based at, and I may be possibly helping lead an expedition in my home state with the CFC.
It's always gratifying to be able to welcome new people into the CFZ family, because we are a family. I've always tried to run the organisation as if it was, and on the whole I've succeeded. However, sadly, like even in the best families, there is the occasional divorce. We are no longer involved with Tropiquaria, the Minehead Zoo that we have been supporting for the last 2 years. Neither the CFZ or I will be having anything to do with it again, at least not in the foreseeable future. We do not want to discuss this matter publicly, and we will give no further details at the moment. Please feel free to carry on visiting the zoo, but be aware that if you do so, it no longer has either the CFZ's or my personal endorsement. But on to more cheerful matters. Young Jordan Warner is doing particularly well at the moment, and the latest edition of Cryptid Hunt is quite possibly the best yet, and it deals with the subject of Mothman and the horrific events of 1967 in Point Pleasant, West Virginia.
It all started when investigator John Keel read about a red-eyed creature reported in West Virginia in a newspaper article. On November 15, 1966, two couples were joyriding around the TNT area, where many of the Mothman sightings occur. Jeff Wamsley describes the sighting.
Linda Scarberry and three other people, her husband Roger and another couple, were up in the TNT area. It's about 7 miles north of here, Point Pleasant. They were just up there riding around. They'd go up the drag race and meet with their friends and things. It's about 11 o'clock at night, and they were coming by what they called the North Power Plant. This was an old vacant building, an old power plant, and they spotted what they thought was a man standing in the middle of the road. As they got closer, they realized that it was some sort of a gigantic bird or a creature of some sort. It ran into the North Power Plant. They got scared and started to head back towards Point Pleasant. And when they hit Route 62, this thing came over top of the car, chased them back into town.
The couples headed straight to the police, but thought Linda Scarberry, her husband, and the two other couples were drinking and thought they were crazy. Soon after, reports of this big bird, as it was dubbed at the time, became a sensation.
That's the historical Mothman sighting. That's what started everything. They went to the sheriff's department, told them what had happened, and that began a rash of sightings for about a year and a half.
The community was on edge, afraid of what was lurking in the black shadows of the night.
A bit peculiar. Wasn't sure what to think. It was a lot of discussion. You know, everybody was around the corner talking. They seen this or they heard this or telling something different. And really sort of scared because you didn't know what you didn't know that he wasn't going to hurt anybody or he was, especially small children. You know, hawks carry children off. And they was afraid that it would come down and pick them up. So they tried to keep the small children in or away from them where they couldn't get to them.
Jordan has done a fantastic job, and I really cannot praise him highly enough. You really have got to watch these shows. So you can check them out on YouTube, or alternatively by following the links either on the CFZ logo or following the links on the Cryptozoology on the Track webpage. But what else have we been doing this month? Well, in the middle of January, we went to London, something I don't usually relish, but this time we went as guests of the prestigious Royal Academy, the focal point of the art. I had been invited by artist Gail Pickering to contribute to an evening of performance art celebrating man's relationship with animals. I quite enjoyed myself because I've always been a bit partial to a piece of avant-garde nonsense here and there, but it's hard to take it seriously if indeed it's meant to be taken seriously. I've always been partial to the avant-garde because of its sheer stupidity. To me, it's funny. To me, it's meant to make you laugh, but I seemed to be the only person in the room laughing, and I looked around and everybody else was taking it so deadly seriously. And I'm sure I caused some raised eyebrows by giggling in places where I wasn't supposed to. However, when I came on stage, I just did my normal act.
Let's try again. I'm a husband
that
steps out of an anarchist composer, a very kind rock singer, an author, a bloody
gave what I believe to be a fair grounding on the subject of cryptozoology, talked a bit about what the CFZ's done over the last 12 months, made a few bad jokes, swore a bit, waved my arms in the air, accepted a drink that someone kindly bought me, and then Karina and I made our way out towards a Thai restaurant with our good friend Dr. Chris Clark. It was actually on the way out of the Royal Academy that I saw what I thought was the best piece of art of the evening. Look at this. See if you can work it out. Yep, it's Wile-E-Coyote and Roadrunner, preserved as museum specimens. And talking of museums, while we were in London, we took the opportunity to go to the Natural History Museum, one of the most fantastic places on Earth, in my opinion. I first visited it in 1963 with my grandfather, and I never tire of going there, even though it has changed immeasurably over the years. My mobility was even worse than normal. For some reason, I'd managed to do my feet in, and I could hardly walk. But I still made a beeline for some of my favourite exhibits, and for those of particular cryptozoological interest. For example, no matter how crippled I was, there's no way could I pay a visit to South Kensington without paying my respects to the dodo, or to the coelacanth, or to the glyptodon, or indeed to Stella's sea cow. No doubt we'll be revisiting the Natural History Museum in a future episode of On the Track, because there's so much that I filmed that I just haven't got room to show you now. But the CFZ has a zoological collection of its own, and this month we received some new inhabitants. They are Mississippi map turtles, and again they're animal rescues which have come to us care of our good friend Beth Tyler King at Heartland Wildlife Rescue. They'll be kept indoors during the winter months, but we're hoping to have a brand new turtle exhibit outside, so all our smaller turtles will be in an outside pond between April and October. Well, I suppose it's time for our usual monthly roundup of new and rediscovered species. Earlier on in the show, I introduced you to our new friend, Derek Grebner. He has done a remarkable job so far, and one of the most spectacular things that he has done is bringing the rest of the cryptozoological world up to speed on a mystery animal sighting that they would almost certainly never have heard about. The American black bear is supposed to have been extirpated from Illinois in about 1868. One that was a straggler was apparently shot in the mid-60s, but apart from that, there have been no other sightings. Now, in June last year, just outside of Buda, Illinois, two farmhands spotted what they thought was a black bear whilst they were working on a grain house. However, on December the 30th, a lady called Cheryl Bansonfine got pictures of the first black bear documented roaming the wilds of Illinois in at least 42 years. The experts that have been consulted on bears using the size reference in the picture say that the bear is at least 500 pounds. This is the sort of sighting which usually ends up relegated to the pages of local newspapers, and which, if it weren't for the hard work of people like Derek, would never be seen by the outside world. Well done, mate. We owe you one. On the 5th of January this year, a North Atlantic white right whale was seen 5 miles south of File Island in the Azores. It is the first confirmed sighting of this species in the Azores since 1888, the year my maternal grandfather was born, the year before Adolf Hitler was born, and the year that Jack the Ripper ran riot in old London town. Well, once upon a time, the species was actually common on both sides of the Atlantic. However, according to the IUCN Red List, it is endangered and appears to be effectively extinct in the eastern North Atlantic. Is this record just a one-off, a straggler, or could it possibly be the beginnings of this magnificent species recolonising the areas where it once lived? I have been keeping birds, mostly softbills, and nearly all rescues, since I was about 7 years old, and this year it will see my 50th birthday. But one of my favourite birds of all is a little bird called the white-eye. And there are quite a few different species of them stretching across from Africa and Asia. But I've always mildly wondered why there are so many different species, because they are all distinct. and it turned out in a report published this week that white eyes actually have the distinction of being able to form new species faster and more efficiently than any other species of bird known. This is particularly because when they are found in island communities, they stay there, they don't try to colonize any other areas, so they become genetically distinct very fast. But the most important thing to find out is why do white eyes speciate so easily? Other species which live in the same habitat and have superficially similar habits and feeding don't, and they seem to keep their genetic integrity to a far greater degree than do the white eyes.
Well guys, that's about it for this episode. I hope you've enjoyed it. Thank you very much to Ol Lewis, to my wife Karina, and to Graham for their camera work this time. Thank you very much to Derek Gremner for all he has done. Thank you to Tim and Fleur and Max and Dave and Matty for all they've done for the CFZ this year. This year is going to be a fantastic year. It's going to be a bumpy ride, so stay with us. It's going to be fun. Until next time, be seeing you.